So, Bobby, we have you by phone now, and I know that you'll be joining us in studio and a little bit later in the program. But I wanted to connect with you because, of course, your cousin, former Congressman Patrick Kennedy, has made quite a bit of news this week. On Sunday night, he was on 60 Minutes to talk about his book, which has been released, and in conjunction with a push that he's making to get some legislation passed in Washington. But I wanted to first start and ask you, because one of the things that I've noticed in the coverage of the book has been that supposedly Patrick's family, the Kennedys, are mad at Patrick because he has somehow crossed a boundary by talking about things that were supposed to be private within the family, supposedly, in public. And I wanted to just get your reaction on that.
Well, there's 100 people in my family, Sam, so I think people are going to have different reactions to Patrick's book. I am personally really proud of Patrick. I think what he's doing is consistent with everything that my family stood for. He's fighting for an issue that he's passionate about, which is civil rights for people with mental illnesses. And he's trying to bring those people into America's democratic fold. He particularly wants to make sure that they feel confident to be out in the open and to be able to fight for their rights against an insurance industry that uses the secretiveness, the embarrassment, the shame, the stigma of mental illnesses to deny them compensation for their health care. In many cases, they are legally entitled to that compensation, but the insurers seldom pay it since they're confident that they can use the stigma to force people with mental illnesses to stand down. And Patrick is standing up for them. You know, Patrick recounts his personal journey in his book, and my family's known for its allergy toward talking about personal issues in public. It's not because of some code of omerta. It originated with the older generation, particularly with my grandmother, who just thought it was self-indulgent and tasteless for people to talk about their personal affairs. She used to always tell us, don't talk about yourselves, talk about your issues. And that ethic has been imbued in my family for generations. And it was regarded as, when I was growing up, as narcissistic to talk about your own personal problems. You can argue whether there's any merit in that approach or whether it's healthy or unhealthy or whatever, but that was part of our family ethic. And I think it was reinforced in my generation by the consciousness that our family stood for certain things and that those things were often unpopular, particularly at the power centers with the press and with powerful corporations and with the ideological right. And, you know, there's a large presence of right-wing ideology in the media that has a fierce antipathy toward my family and for all the things we stand for. And they know that gossip sells more papers and draws more eyeballs and serious discussion of issues. So gossip about my family fits both their political agenda and their financial agenda. So by attacking us personally or reporting lurid gossip or our political opponents could discredit our issues and make money for themselves. So any piece of personal gossip, whether it was true or not, became fodder to discredit our issues and drive circulation and advertising revenues. So naturally, there was a guardedness in my generation. But having said that, that guardedness among my family, when we're out in the political world, doesn't extend to our relationships with friends and family. In private, I think there's a tremendous openness within our family and within our large army of close, trusted friends.
And it seems to me that part of that that silence about not speaking about issues within the family also sort of extended to some measure of a sense of responsibility. Particularly when it came to Teddy dealing with the assassination of his brothers, your uncle and your father, and that it really did seem he was completely isolated in terms of having any outlet, having any access to really anyone who was, you know, at arm's length from the situation to discuss it. I mean, it seems like there was a tremendous amount of pressure on him. And I imagine, and I guess this is what I'm asking you, if that extends to the family insofar as that we've got to put on a face for people, not just, you know, the rest of the family, but really, I mean, in many respects, to the country, because, you know, your family have been seminal figures in the modern history of the United States.
Well, it's a combination of things. Teddy was, you know, utterly crushed by my father's assassination, and he'd already been devastated by the death of my Uncle Jack and his elder brother Joe and my grandfather's debilitating stroke. His three elder brothers had all died in the service of their country, and all of them died violently. And he was traumatized. Patrick's notion, you know, that he says that Teddy suffered post-traumatic stress disorder and that he was self-medicating with alcohol. And, you know, I think that's plausible. Teddy had a hard time talking about anything to do with his brother's death or with my cousin John's, which totally shattered his heart. I did succeed on one occasion in getting him to talk about the Warren Commission report, but it was an agonizing discussion. And he just had a visceral unwillingness. He would wince, his eyes would tear up, and he was, till the end of his life, he was profoundly and dramatically affected, almost as if it was day one. And he never got over that. Teddy, you know, was by nature, he was conservative, and that's ironic, but he was conservative, and he was a traditional, pious Catholic. He went to confession. He talked to his priest. He had a very strong relationship with an Irish priest named Father Jerry Creighton, and with a number of other priests with whom he felt comfortable talking about personal stuff. My generation grew up, I think, more comfortable talking about very intimate things in other settings, but Teddy, you know, Teddy really was a product of the old school. And also, there was an ethic in my family that we didn't have much right to complain about anything because we were so lucky in so many ways. We had wealth, we had education, we had wonderful friends, we had a supportive family. There were kids in Harlem and Watts and other parts of the country who lost their fathers to gun violence every day, and they didn't have the support system. They didn't have the resources that we did. My mother always told us, everybody takes their licks, and, you know, life is hard for everybody, and it's easier on balance for us than it is for most of the people on the planet. And, you know, that was an important perspective, and it was a perspective that made it easy to stay grateful. And, you know, and there was also this thing against complaining. Any kind of complaining or self-pity was definitely discouraged in our family. My grandfather, Joseph Kennedy, would clap his hands and say, "No whining in this house, no long faces." And I don't think that's that bad. You know, there's kind of a peril to dwelling too much in the past. And I think the feeling was, you know, you can look, but don't stare. If you dwell too long in your injuries or your troubles or your tragedies, you can get stuck there. It's like swallowing poison in a way. You have to move forward. We all ultimately have to move forward, and we have to create our own lives, our own narratives. I don't think it was necessarily an unhealthy impulse not to dwell too much on those tragedies. My aunt Eunice Shriver, she'd often tell us that she'd say there are too many important things going on right now to be worried about yourself. There's too many problems that can actually be solved. There's too many problems that you have the ability to be effective in solving. And my own experience was that I had a much greater comfort talking about the assassinations among some members of our generation and a lot with my children than my Uncle Teddy or my father's other siblings ever did during their lives.
I know that there have been reports that there are members of your family that are upset about that. There's some question as to, will this mar in any way Ted Kennedy's legacy? What are your thoughts on that?
I don't think so. I don't think people in our family will be overly upset, or in any event, I don't think that they're going to stay upset for too long with Patrick. Everybody loves Patrick. All of us admire what he's doing. I certainly think that he's got tremendous courage, and I respect him for that. His experience with his father and his expectations from that relationship, I think, were different, maybe really very different than the rest of us. Patrick talks about an intervention that he participated in with Teddy, where Teddy walked out. But, you know, many of us participated in interventions that year with Uncle Teddy. And more than a dozen of us from two generations were involved in various coordinated interventions that year. My own experience was a very good one with Teddy. I flew to Washington. I talked to him for a long time, over an hour in his office, and he responded very positively, and he was both grateful and gracious. And in the end, I think it was a combination of all those interventions and his subsequent marriage to Vicky that really helped to change the way that he interacted with the world and the way that he used alcohol. He never stopped, you know, of course. Everybody was urging total abstinence, and he never made it to that point. But he moderated his drinking so that after 1992, it was no longer causing serious problems in his life. I think everybody in my generation at various times had some anger at Teddy, but over time, I think we all forgave him. We especially knew that he'd been crushed by my father's death and by the death of his three older brothers. He was left raising 20 fatherless children, my 11 brothers and sisters, John Kennedy's two kids, Peter Lawford's four children, plus three of his own. And he never missed our birthdays. He attended all of our weddings. He was at every graduation. He returned to every phone call, usually within the hour. It was really extraordinary to me how hard he tried, how reliable he was as a surrogate father. I have literally hundreds of letters from my Uncle Teddy. When he traveled, he sent these funny postcards. He sent reminders on commemorative anniversaries for our family and for our country. He would write congratulatory notes whenever I published an op-ed in the New York Times or some other paper. He would take those publications and have them reprinted in the Congressional Record to show that he was proud of me. He wasn't just doing this for us, for me and my brothers and sisters and my cousins. He was doing it for our in-laws. And he was doing it for distant friends and for relatives and for literally hundreds of people across the state and across the country. He called or visited every Gold Star family in the state of Massachusetts, every family that lost a child in war. And he, of course, was a Gold Star child himself because his brother died in World War II. He called or he visited 140 Massachusetts families who lost loved ones in the World Trade Center attacks, and he wouldn't just make a call and that would be it. He would follow up oftentimes many, many times over the years. Every Tuesday, he quietly drove to inner city Washington, D.C. to read to public school children. Ken Burns, the documentary filmmaker, told me that he met a little girl from Southeast Washington who never knew that for 3 years the man who read to her every Tuesday was a United States senator. Oh, and his staff didn't even know that he was doing that. At his, you know, when we had his funeral, 20,000 people appeared spontaneously at his wake. And I took my six children out to shake their hands, and we spent the evening out on that line, and they were immigrants for whom he'd gotten a green card. They were soldiers who he'd helped into the VA. They were senior citizens who he'd helped get their Social Security. I remember one man was the father of an illegal Costa Rican immigrant who had died fighting for the United States Marines in Iraq. And Teddy had arranged for his burial in Arlington. And then, you know, he did all that personal stuff. Then he was also doing his full-time job as senator. His fingerprints are on over 1,000 bills. He's probably the most productive senator in the history of the United States Senate. You know, all of the social issues that we care about, Sam, about Medicaid, Medicare, school lunch, you know, think about them, senior citizens, housing, education, American Indians, migrant workers, civil rights, voting rights, minimum wage, gay rights. he was a Senate leader on all of those, on health care and AIDS research, on religious freedom, a million other things, immigration, arms control, gun control. He led the battles in the Senate against torture during the Bush administration, up against eavesdropping, against apartheid during Reagan's administration, and against Reagan's Central American wars, and against both wars in Iraq. You go down the issues, Sam, that you care about, and the principal legislation almost always was certainly drafted by Ted Kennedy. We knew what he was doing, and we also had a special consciousness of the burden that he was carrying around with him, and that, I think, made it easier for us to forgive him for some of his excesses for which he was famous, particularly in the two decades after my father's death, at a time when he was really suffering.
Lastly, Bobby, give us a sense of Patrick's legislation. How big of a deal do you think this is?
You know, I think that's exactly why most people in my family will end up really applauding Patrick. He's a serious person. He's smart. He knows what he's talking about. And this is a critical issue that no one else is championing. The media tends to highlight the gossipy aspects of the book and to ignore its much more serious purpose. And I think it's clear that he made these personal disclosures to advance an issue about which he's really passionate. And that's the issue of people of mental illness. And it's really the last frontier, Sam, for civil rights in this country. It's consistent with all the things that my family has done over the generations in terms of reaching out and forcing our American democracy to be more inclusive. My family was at the forefront of the civil rights movement during the 1960s and during the White House years. And then after Jack's assassination, Teddy's first bill was the Voting Rights Act of 1964, which he helped usher through the Senate in the wake of my Uncle Jack's death. My father became champion for migrant farm workers who were completely excluded from protection by the American labor laws since the 1930s. And again, my father championed their plight and that of the American Indians and the people of Appalachia and the Mississippi Delta, all of these forgotten Americans who had been, you know, left behind by our political system. The Kennedys and the Shrivers were the spear tip and the spear shaft in the civil rights movement for intellectually disabled people. My aunt Eunice created Special Olympics, and Anthony Shriver, her son, created Best Buddies. The JPK Foundation, which he ran, forced Americans to stop warehousing people with intellectual disabilities and to bring them into the mainstream. And, you know, we fought to bring them out of the darkness of shame and give them full citizenship. And that was probably, arguably, one of the most important civil rights movements in world history. And Teddy wrote the Americans with Disabilities Act, which gave full civil rights and citizenship rights to people with physical disabilities. And then gay rights, Teddy was the first person, the first national politician to put gay rights on the Democratic Party agenda. He forced in 1980, against tremendous opposition, he forced a gay rights plank into the Democratic platform. He was the movement's original political champion. And, you know, with all these different expansions of American democracy, our family has always been at the forefront. Going back to my great-grandfather, Honey Fitz's proudest achievement when he was in Congress, he was mayor of Boston, the first, you know, ghetto Irish mayor of Boston, but he was also in Congress, which he hated, but his proudest moment in Congress was killing Henry Cabot Lodge's literacy requirements, which were designed to exclude Italian immigrants from taking part in the democratic process and to keep them out of the voting booths. So, you know, I think the last frontier of all those battles and the last barrier is for people who have mental illnesses. Under the law, people with mental illnesses generally are entitled to health insurance. They're entitled to treatment in hospitals, but the insurance companies systematically deny that, and they deny them coverage, believing that, you know, they'll be too ashamed and or too embarrassed or too fragile to stand up for themselves. And Patrick's effort is to say, we are coming out of the darkness. People who have these illnesses have a right to treatment. They are our brothers. They are our sisters. We need to take care of them as Americans. We can't advance our country by leaving our poor brothers and sisters behind or the vulnerable behind. And Patrick has stood up to say, I have this illness myself. He's giving other people the courage to do the same. And I think he needed to start that journey by telling his own story of mental illness. And I think it's noble and it's heroic. And you know, I have nothing, Sam, but admiration for him.